Okay, in this tutorial, we are going to go through our Blender Gaussian splat creation process. And this will let us take a fully rendered Blender scene and actually crunch it down into a Gaussian splat that can then be rendered in real time on JetSet, retaining all the original lighting and reflections and information of the Blender scene, which is quite a remarkable process. And in Blender, the Gaussian splat doesn't actually display quite as well, but in JetSet, it'll actually display quite well. But let's get started. First of all, in our Blender scene, in this case, it's a photogrammetry scene, so it can render pretty quickly, but the same use pattern will work for pretty much any Blender scene. And we're going to first download and install our normal AutoShot Blender add-on. So we will go to our downloads file, and we'll go down to our Blender add-on, and we're going to click download, and it'll download that to our downloads file. Okay, there we go. And then we're going to go to Blender, and we're going to go to our Edit, Preferences, and then Add-ons, and go to our little Install from Disk, and go pick out our, type in AutoShot. There we go, there's AutoShot Blender, and there's the most recent 1.16 version we want. Okay, so that says it's installed. We can check for it. There we go. And we can see that we have the current version installed. All right, great. So that's what we need. And in order to generate a Gaussian splat, we actually have to first generate a series of images of your existing 3D scene. So we can see here in our AutoShot tab here, you can hit N to make this appear. There's the tab. And under our splat training, you may have to open up this, we can see that there's a series of steps that we can go through to create our camera paths. And we actually first create geometry to represent where all the cameras are going to be. In this case, I'm going to click on make an icosphere pattern mesh. I'll pick the default radius and the subdivisions, and it'll make an icosphere. And we can see that it's just dropped it into the scene, depending on where I had the last object selected. We actually want to unparent it. So I'm going to hit Alt P, and I'm going to clear the parent and keep the transformation. And then we can just hit G and move it around the scene to the locations where we want. And what we're looking for is some centralized locations so that we can avoid intersecting geometry while still getting a pretty complete coverage. And in fact, what we're also going to want to do is, you'll see this scene has multiple areas in it. We're going to be generating the cameras based on all the faces of the mesh. In this case, if we generated all the cameras, there's no mesh faces anywhere over here. And we're actually going to want some of those. So let's go ahead and we're going to hit Tab for edit mode. Hit A to copy all the faces, and then Shift D to duplicate. And then we're going to move our duplicated mesh over to here. And we'll just move it around with the usual grab commands, the usual Blender grab commands. Then if I hit Tab again, we go back out of edit mode. And so you can see that I've turned our single camera icosphere into two camera icospheres that can be distributed around the range that you want to cover. And we can do three, but you get the idea. And this way we can actually have complete camera coverage in all these different areas. Okay, so now we've got our icospheres, our kind of our geometry reference to position where our cameras are going to be. Note that we have unparented this, so we're not parenting underneath something else in the scene. We're going to go ahead and click the camera track from the face normals. We can pick our default focal length, and we'll use both directions. So it'll have a camera facing inward and outwards from each of these surface normals. And it's going to generate a splat camera. And as we can see down here, there's the animation of the splat camera. So it's as we run through the animated sequence, we can see where that camera is going to show up anywhere. Here we can turn off the icosphere so we can see that a little bit better. But the camera is now taking an image of the scene from every one of those icosphere polygons. Great. So it's going to give us 300 some images, which will give us a very good reference for this scene. So once we've generated that camera, we then need to tell it where we're going to be rendering the images. And this is an important step. So we're going to go down to our output panel and we're going to open up our folder. And we have our, inside our model file, I just created a separate splat folder to hold some of the splat information. We're going to right click, make a new folder and call it images. There we go. And we can actually name this output folder something besides images. We'll just use that name for now. Just remember that as we're going to be dragging and dropping that folder into PostShot later. And then we're going to call the file, we can just call it chamber, and then an underscore. by putting chamber underscore, it will number the files after chamber with the frame number, and that's going to be important later on. And then we're putting it into the images subfolder. So I'm going to click accept. Okay, and then the rendering frame rate doesn't matter. We're just going to render 320 frames of this. So we can just go over and click our render and render animation. Oops, I have it set to cycles. Gonna take a long time. So go ahead back and set that to Eevee. We're running Blender 4.2, so this is Eevee Next. So it will render very quick. All right, so there we go. So it's gonna go through and render 320 of these animation images of the scene. So we'll let it go ahead and do that. Okay, so we've rendered all 300 some images. And now while our Splat camera is selected, we can actually look at our directory. So let's go look at our output directory. And we're just gonna click this open. And we can see that it's rendered all these images into that directory. Chamber 01, 02, all the way down to chamber 315. In addition to that, we're going to need to generate our metadata XMP files. And this is going to be what tells Reality Capture to not move the cameras around, to just use the cameras locked where they were, as we have precise camera location information because we just generated the cameras. So with our Splat camera selected, we're going to click Export Reality Capture XMP. And we'll click OK. And it'll export those. Now let's go ahead and take a look at our output folder once again. And for each rendered JPEG image, we now have a matching named XMP file. That's a text file that contains the position and orientation of the cameras, along with a few other pieces of detail. But this is the key part we need to know. Okay, once we have our rendered images, now we can actually run Reality Capture. Now, Reality Capture was purchased by Epic Games. And so now we can actually go into our Epic Games launcher and click on Reality Capture. And if you need to install it, you can install it. It's free. It's a great tool. And the script actually expects that it's going to be in a default location. So if you run into problems with the location of Reality Capture, then let us know and we can put in a piece to handle that. All right, so back in Blender, we're going to click Run Reality Capture. And it's going to open up a little script that is remote controlling Reality Capture to load in all the image sequences from the images folder. And it's going to load them in along with the XMP files. And it's going to start aligning all the images. And it'll go through this actually quite quickly for about 300 some images. There we go. And it's completely run Reality Capture for you, so you don't really need to know actually how Reality Capture works. We can exit. We'll pull over our folder with this. Here's our images subfolder. And in addition to our originally rendered JPEG files, we now have a couple more files at the bottom. And we actually have a cameras.csv file. And this contains the position and orientation of all the camera positions that we're going to use in PostShot. Once again, we are retaining the camera positions from Blender through Reality Capture and into PostShot just so that all of our coordinate systems will line up correctly. And in addition, it's actually generated a sparse model, point cloud model, of our scene. The automated script just did that all in Reality Capture, so we don't need to know how Reality Capture really works. The script just automates this. And currently this is only on Windows, so as Reality Capture is only on Windows, as is PostShot, but most people working in Gaussian Splats are already using these tools anyway. Okay, so now we're going to bring up another tool, which is PostShot. Right now it's a free tool while it's in beta. It's a great tool for generating Gaussian Splats. We are going to bring up our same images folder. Going to go up one directory, and we're just going to drag and drop the images folder right into PostShot. And since we have written out the CSV files and the sparse supply file in the format that PostShot expects, it's going to take a second to load it up. Going to think for a bit. All right, and then it is asking us how we want to import our images and train it. And in fact, all we want to do is uncheck Start Training and then click Import. All right, and here we can see we have brought in, you can see all of our camera positions from our two spheres. You can see that our origin is correct. So our origin matches what we had in the original model. And our camera positions also all match. So things are all in alignment. All right, so now we can just click Start Training. And we can watch PostShot go to work. And what it's going to be doing is it's going to take all those images that we rendered along with our sparse alignment and our camera positions from reality capture. And it's going to start generating a Gaussian splat model of the scene. Actually, pretty quickly, it starts to converge. You can see how the different pieces of geometry are going to converge here. There we go. And it starts already to look like something of our original scene. And we're going to let this cook for a while. It looks like down here we've got another 11 minutes for it to cook through the scene. So we'll let it finish training, and then we can look at the result. All right, I'm actually going to pause here. Click pause training. The longer it goes, the larger of a Gaussian splat it'll generate. And sometimes we may actually want to have a smaller one to fit more easily into JetSet. We can do a couple different levels of quality here, but I'm going to go ahead and go export splat model. And I'm going to go back to the same splat directory we were there before, and we'll just call this chamber splat 05.py, and we'll save that. And let's take a look at the size of that. Okay, so that adds actually a 700 megabyte splat model. That might be a little bit big. In that case, I could have paused the training a little bit earlier, but we'll try it out and we'll see how well this works. So we're going to go back into Blender. Once again, we are going to make sure we can hit N to see our side tabs. We're going to go up to 3D Gaussian splatting. And just like we did in the earlier Blender Gaussian splat intro, we're going to click Import Gaussian Splatting. I'm going to pick our chamber splat 05. I'm going to import it. All right. And I'm going to hit Z and switch to wireframe so we can see our point cloud. And we can see that in general, we have a reasonably well aligned point cloud. So I'm going to go inside the scene. I'm going to switch to our material preview so we can see our Gaussian splat. And our Gaussian splat inside Blender looks like a slightly kind of fuzzier version of the original Blender scene, but we can click it on and off. Here's our Gaussian splatting imported, and we can just toggle on and off our display so we can actually see that it's lining up pretty well with our original geometry. And again, the Blender display of the Gaussian splats is not particularly optimal, but it'll look better in JetSet. Okay, so this is good, but we see we've got the same problem we had earlier. I'm going to going to our object tab. When we imported the Gaussian splat, the Gaussian splat importer automatically added a minus 90 degree rotation in the x-axis. And we actually are going to want to remove that and but re-add that in our splat loop. Go ahead and right-click and make a new collection, and we'll just call this export. Splat export. And we're going to go ahead and click on our Gaussian splatting, hit M, and we're going to move that to splat export, and we'll move our splat camera to our original geometry, and we'll move our icosphere to our original, we'll select our icosphere and move that to, maybe we'll do that. Let's see how that's working there. M, there we go. And move that to original geometry, because we're going to end up disabling the original geometry because we only want to export the splat model along with our scene locators. Okay, we've got that, but again, let's go back to the core problem we have with our Gaussian splats, and that's our negative 90 degree rotation in the X. So we're going to go ahead and hit Shift A and add an empty, and we're going to hit F2 to rename that, and we're going to call that splat loc. And in this particular case, the suffix doesn't matter as much because we can only load a Gaussian splat in the scene, but we can call it splat 05, I think was what we called it. And let's go ahead and remove our position because we actually don't want to change the position of this. And we're going to go click on our splat, our Gaussian splat, and we're going to, actually let's turn on our original geometry so we can see how this is going to align. I'm going to hide the icosphere. There we go. So again, just to verify, here's our Gaussian splat, and we can see that it lines up with the original geometry. Now, if I take the Gaussian splat and I switch that to zero, and all of a sudden it doesn't align. All right. So we're going to take the Gaussian splat and hold down Control, click on the splat loc, hit Control P for parent. And we're going to pick object without inverse. We don't want to add in any hidden transforms in there. And in our splat locator, I'm going to select that, and we're going to hit minus 90. And that puts our transform and matches it. So let's take a look at our top view and shift to wireframe. And we can see that our point cloud actually matches our geometry pretty well. Let's once again go in and hit Z and go to material preview. And this way we can, once again, toggle back and forth our display of our Gaussian splatting versus our original scene. And we can see the Gaussian splatting is once again lined up correctly, but with no transforms in the Gaussian splat itself. All the transforms are contained in the splat loop. All right, let's hit save. And now we can actually uncheck our original geometry. We are only going to export our Gaussian splats to JetSet. We can go to File and Export our Universal Scene Description. And I've created a USD and USDZ directory in this particular project. So we'll go to our USD directory and we'll export our Great Chamber Splat, call it 02. You can use either USD suffix or USDC. USD defaults to a compressed binary version of USD. And the USDC is also the same binary version, which is fine. We want visible only, and we don't have any animation in this particular scene. Okay, so we're going to export that. And then we, of course, in as usual, go in an AutoShot, and I've set my USD folder. I'm going to refresh. Select our Great Chamber Splat 02, and we're going to make a USDZ file out of that. That generates that, and we can push that, and we can push this to JetSet. And in this particular case, I'm going to showcase how fast it is if we have a direct USB-C to Ethernet connection to JetSet. So I just plugged it in, going to refresh our IP address. Great. And I'm going to first transfer Great Chamber Splat 02, which transfers very quickly. That's no surprise, that's small. But let's try transferring chambersplat05.ply. And I'm going to push that file to JetSet. And you can see that it is sending over Ethernet at 500-some megabytes per second. So it's a lot faster than sending it over Wi-Fi. So if you're sending lots of big files back and forth to JetSet, you're definitely going to want to load this in. Here we are over in JetSet. And I'm going to click Model Open. And we're going to open our Great Chamber Splat 02. As before, we don't see anything yet. It just has our different scene locators. There's our origin. We're going to then go to our model and open this and now open our Great Chamber, our splat05.ply. I'm going to open that up. It takes a second to load it in. There we go. And there is our model. As before, if we switch to our fireplace, there's our fireplace. And again, this is all Gaussian splat, so it retains the original camera information. And lighting information and reflection information that you would have in an actual render. So there's our main door. And of course, over here, as we were further away from the icospheres, so it's a little bit rougher, but over here in the, over by the fireplace and where the main spheres were, it's actually very clean. So if we wanted an even cleaner model, you might need to add another one of the spheres to get a more complete capture. But this gives you a good idea of how it can work. We're going to be adding in a methodology to package in the Gaussian splat along with the USDZ into a single USDZ file. But this is the manual method, and it'll work up until then.